So my name is Tracie Addy. I work here at the Center for Teaching and Learning, and I co-direct our National Summer Institutes on Scientific Teaching. I also work with faculty teaching initiatives. And this past semester, I had the pleasure of teaching a course that was scientific teaching for life sciences for graduate students and postdocs. So what I want to talk about today is basically how I piloted, I consider it a huge pilot, a tool on the peer review in Canvas. Okay, so just a little bit of context so that you know my course. I co-taught PBS 879, which is, again, the theory and practice of scientific teaching for life sciences. The level of this course was graduate students and postdocs, mostly postdocs, about 16 to 4 or so graduate students. But this tool could be used in any type of class, undergraduate, et cetera. So the assignment that my students had was to create a diversity statement. So a lot of these postdocs or grad students will be going out to the job market. So we have a variety of tools in the class focused on career development. And one of them was creating a diversity statement. So this is the prompt they were given basically to kind of simulate if they were applying to a position and they had to prepare this particular statement. So why did I use the peer review tool? Well, essentially, our students, you know, being postdocs and graduate students, a lot of them had this season of missing classes. So they had conferences, they had a whole bunch of things. So I think in the month of April, we actually Zoomed our class so that all of our virtual students could come in because of all of their many, you know, obligations and whatnot. And so what I thought was, because we had a two-part session on diversity statements, one being what is a diversity statement, the second being you're part of the hiring committee, how can we train you to look at criteria to evaluate the diversity statement and to actually do that peer review in class. I thought it would be great to be able to have the students that weren't able to come to actually still do the peer review. So this was the rationale. So there was a subset of students that were to complete basically this assignment online, just for, you know, hopeful reasons. It is a non-credit course, but they sign up and they apply to take this course. So they're usually pretty serious about it. Okay, so this is what I did for peer review. So essentially, in our Canvas course site, I created an assignment that was essentially peer review. And I basically told them, you know, upload your draft of your diversity statement. And what I did when I actually went in was I paired specific students, and you can do this in Canvas, which is great, with other students. So everybody was supposed to, in class, have two people review their statement. So I set up the same option on Canvas for those students who are going to be virtual as well. Now, a couple of neat things that I think Canvas can do for peer review is that you can actually implement a grading rubric inside the actual peer review feature. So I did this because actually in class, we went over the rubric. We went through the hiring committee based upon the hiring committee of a particular institution out in California. So we kind of used that as a model. And I created the criteria based upon this and then to basically plug them into the rubric function and also added a couple of other areas there. So what the students can do when their peer review person they're paired with uploads their particular statement, they can actually see their statement. And so it's a nice window view of their statement, as if you have a Microsoft Word document almost up. And then they also show this particular rubric, so they can actually edit and give comments directly on their document, and they can also give comments and feedback on the rubric. I was very interested in the rubric per se, because we wanted to say, well, would you hire this person based on their diversity statement, although they'd have a whole package, but would you actually hire them? And so they could actually tally the items to figure out, you know, if they had a high score or not. So what were some benefits? So obviously I talked a little bit about, well, my students were not in class, so how could we still have them have a similar experience? And creating it outside of class digitally definitely did this in some ways for them. Students can be assigned, as I mentioned, specific partners, so you can pair them up. You can also, though, do this anonymously. So you can actually do anonymous peer reviews as well. Depends on your goals, what you desire in the course. Students can insert comments directly in, so I think that's also a bonus. I don't know if Canvas always had that option, but I think it's pretty neat to actually be able to write to insert on the document itself. And you can upload rubrics or criteria in any form or fashion. Okay, so there were a few challenges that I'd like to also express too. This is my first time using the tool in the class. So students, I realized some of them, they needed to kind of know how to use the tool. So I probably should have, in the beginning, showed a few of them how before they left and went off into all their places. But I think I just needed to give a little bit more structure there. One of the students was abroad. And didn't have the proper software. I don't know why. I'd have to ask the campus at another point, but we just said, you know, when you come back to the United States, just, you know, do it then. That's perfectly fine. But some of the software, whatever happened, was incompatible. And if the peer reviewer's partner didn't upload their assignment, obviously they can't start. So I think it's a good idea if you use the tool to, you know, definitely set deadlines. We did that, encourage the students to actually upload so they're not always waiting for their peer reviewer to come up. The nice thing that happens is on the Canvas site, you can see who's your peer, who you're going to peer review if you don't do it anonymously as well. And then they can, you know, kind of see if that person has uploaded their files as well. So that's essentially what, you know, I did for uploading the peer review tool. I'd like to do it again on maybe a larger scale. I think there was only about 5 or 6 students that actually used it in our complete class. But overall, I think it was, you know, it was valuable for them. They still feel like they were part of the class, even though they weren't physically present, and they were still able to do this process as well. I imagine that you can also do it, you know, if you want to have students do it outside of class, right? So just because, you know, you don't want to do the peer review in the class, you could use this tool as well as an option, so that you don't have to devote the actual class time to it. So that's it. So I'd love to take any questions.
Mm-hmm. Could you, as the instructor, see all of the comments that the mm-hmm. peers gave one another?
Yes, and that's a nice thing too. Yes, I can actually see everything that they wrote. So that's great, because I can use it, you know, in my, we didn't grade the actual assignment itself, but I can actually go in and I can actually, could actually grade it and how they did their peer review. And I could actually comment upon it too, as well. So I think it's a really nice, you know, feature.
Mm-hmm. And when you comment, is that in the sidebar or in the document?
So you can comment directly in the document, and then the rubric is kind of on the side as well. So you can kind of see, like I can, when I go in, I can actually see this is what scores they got on the actual rubric, which is not showing right now. Where do they insert comments or, you know, suggestions in the actual document?
And that's on in assignments too, even if it weren't a peer thing. They upload
yes.
a Word doc.
Oh, on the actual assignments, yeah. So if you do any other type of assignment, uh-huh. It's pretty much like that, yeah, yeah. Yeah, it's pretty similar.
Can you assign teaching fellows the same sort of access?
Oh, that's probably, I'm assuming. Can teaching fellows, I have to ask canvassing, can teaching fellows view your entire course, right?
So theoretically. They have the exact same access as an instructor, okay. So they yeah. would be able to see that.
And that's what perfect. Are there any plans if you have undergraduate graders or learning assistants?
We do have a role specifically for grader, and I'm happy to talk about that later on if you'd like to contact me.
Good question. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You said there was one person that had problems being able to access it. Was mm-hmm. it just in general for Canvas, or is it before the user function?
The actual functions in Canvas, so they couldn't log in to Canvas, but again, they were abroad, so I don't know the computer access, and we thought it would be too complicated to, you know, so I told them to come back, but it was the functions in Canvas, so I have no idea, you know, why. It's a good question. Uh-huh.
I can share some of our experience. We are working with global network schools in mm-hmm. countries, and when our students or students from other business schools around the world, especially if they're accessing from China, mm-hmm.
Yeah, I think that was his major issue. He couldn't open the actual file in Canvas, so he couldn't see his partner's document. Mm-hmm. Any other questions? Thank you.